Good morning, everybody. We are entering 62nd session of Lex webinar series. And as you all know very well that we never compromise on the quality of topic and the quality of resource person. And the number of participants who join the webinar even before the time has come shows that the resource person of the day is a much sought for resource person who is known for his in-depth knowledge about whatever subject he deals with. This is Nagamuthu, has been a darling of the masses, especially advocates in Madurai and Chennai court. Not even a single word is exaggerated from his mouth. I know him as an advocate even before his elevation. And he is a all-rounder in the legal field, whether it is civil cases or writ cases or service law or criminal law. His knowledge is very deep and of multifarious levels. And we are delighted to have Mr. S. Nagamuthu, former judge of Madras High Court and currently the senior advocate of Supreme Court of India, to be a resource person. And webinars have become a dime a dozen, and it is almost ruling the roost. But not all webinars and not all lectures are going to have etching effect in the annals of the lecture series. And today, we are delighted to have Mr. Justice Nagamuthu as a resource person. And the topic he has chosen is something very unique, interesting, and it has got its own application in the profession of law, both for the bench and the bar. With this small introductory note, may I request Justice Nagamuthu to commence the deliberation. Sir, you are welcome, sir. The floor is yours.
Good morning to all our friends. At the outset, I should thank Mr. Srinivas Raghavan and his team for having provided me yet another platform to be with you and to share my experience on an important topic which was never taught to any of us before in the law colleges. Any lawyer who practices on the criminal side should know as to what the forensic medicine is all about, and also should know as to what the criminal forensic science as such. Without having fundamental knowledge of these two subjects, I don't think that we will be in a better position to deal with any case relating to offenses against the human body. That is a topic that we have chosen today. I don't claim that I know everything in forensic medicine. I know a little, which I gained out of my own experience. My aim today is only to trigger your thinking on this subject and also to impress upon you the importance of this subject besides forensic science, so that you will develop more interest in the subject. And in due course of time, you will be in a better position to do cases, not only the time of trial, even at the time of appeal, so that real justice goes to the litigant before the court. As I pointed out, forensic medicine is a branch of forensic science. Forensic medicine is taught in medical colleges during their undergraduation, mostly during second year or third year. And most of the doctors do not show much interest in forensic medicine. But those doctors who have not shown much interest in learning the forensic medicine are asked to do postmortem examinations and also give opinion in respect of injuries on human bodies in the courts of law, without realizing the responsibility, if I may say so. I really regret to say so, that many doctors come to the court and under the impression that because they have been summoned by the police at the instant, they are supposed to speak whatever the police want. This is the general impression that doctors do have nowadays. In this scenario, the job of a lawyer defending an accused
becomes more onerous. The doctor is a medical expert, whereas we are not experts in medical science. Unless we know a little about the medical science, the various systems in the human body functioning, the human anatomy, and more particularly the forensic medicine, I don't think that we will be a match to the doctor in the box to give evidence so that we can elicit the real position of the deceased and the consequences. That is how this subject, in my perception, becomes very, very important for us to know. Now, today, I don't think that I will be in a position to cover every aspect of forensic medicine. I will cover only few areas which have got some close link or connection with the appendages relating to human body. And if time permits, in due course on a different day, I will go into the minute details of the injuries on the human body, the cause of death, etc. Today, to begin with, now I'm going to touch upon the practical aspects of the matter. Here is a case where a doctor comes to the court and he gives evidence in respect of his examination of the person while he was alive. He makes an entry, you know very well, he makes entry in the medical record that is MLC. We call it as accident register in our state. In that MLC register, he makes so many entries. Now, the first part of the MLC, namely the accident register, gives the details of and other particulars of the injured who was examined by the doctor, like name, native place, father's name, etc., age, etc. These things are given. Then the next one is, there is a statement as to whether the person was conscious or not. This, in every case, you have to note as to what was entered, what was the condition of the injured when he was brought to the hospital, whether he was conscious, unconscious, or semi-conscious. These are the three broad classifications made by the doctors. So that also you should take note of, because this plays a vital role in various aspects of the dying declarations. I'll come to that a little more later. Now, this is the second one. The next entry the doctor makes is the statement of the injured. That is recorded. He records, alleged to have been assaulted by so-and-so person, etc. This is not his opinion. This is nothing but the recording of the statement which was made by the injured person. This is the statement. This is the earliest statement in many of the cases which come into being, which is being recorded by a public authority. If the person goes to the police station first, he makes a complaint there. That becomes the first statement, the earliest statement. Thereafter, he makes a statement before the doctor. This becomes the second statement. In many of the cases, the injured, as soon as the occurrence, goes to the hospital. He makes the statement that is the earliest in point of time recorded by the doctor in the action register. This earliest statement also plays a vital role. This is not opinion. This is simple recording by a public authority who is a disinterested person in the case of the prosecution or in the case of the defense. Now, the next part in the action register is the injuries noted by the doctor. To this extent, when he notes down the injuries, injury number one, this, injury number two on the head, injury number two on the leg, third on the chest, when he records all these things, the doctor becomes an eyewitness in respect of the injuries. He is an eyewitness. You see how many roles a doctor plays at the time when he examines the witness. When he records the injuries found on the body, he acts as an eyewitness. He notices the injuries and the records, the injuries on the action register. So he is an eyewitness to that extent. Then lastly, he gives opinion. He is a doctor, a medical expert, falling under Section 45 of the Evidence Act. His opinion may or may not be acceptable to the court. His opinion is the last one. After following all the other formalities which I have already said, which are officially required, he gives his final opinion. His opinion may be like this. He may say that the injury is grievous. This is opinion. He may say that the injuries are the injuries would have been caused by this kind of weapon. This is his opinion. He may say that the injuries would have been caused at or about this time, that is around 6 to 8 o'clock in the morning or 9 to 10, like that, the range of time he would have given. So on these three aspects, the doctor gives opinion. This is his opinion falling under Section 45 of the Evidence Act. Now, when you cross-examine the doctor, so far as the first part is concerned, namely where he recounts the details of the injured, there can be no dispute at all. You need not cross-examine. You need not concentrate on that first. Secondly, when the doctor recalls that he was conscious, unconscious, or semi-conscious, it plays a role, because after making the statement, if the man dies out of these injuries, then the statement made by him to the doctor becomes a dying declaration. This dying declaration is to be tested on the touchstone of the consciousness or otherwise of the deceased, namely the injured person at that time. So to that extent, you have to concentrate in this also, whether man was conscious or unconscious. This you have to see. Then comes the statement. This statement, if the man survives, then this statement is nothing but a former statement of that person. When he comes to the court, this statement can be used to contradict him as provided in Section 145 of the Evidence Act. Or else, it can be used by the prosecution as a former statement for the purpose of corroboration. That is the only role that this part of the statement plays when the man survives. So many a times what we do is that we do not cross-examine the witness about the statement. Because I have pointed out to you, this being a previous statement can be used for the purpose of contradiction. Contradiction means what? The way in which it is to be put to the maker of the statement as provided in Section 145 of the Evidence Act. Section 145 states that if you want to contradict him, you have to bring to the witness, the notice of the witness, about this statement. This is in a way providing an opportunity or affording an opportunity to the witness about the contradictory statement. Suppose in the court he says that 5 persons attacked, whereas to the doctor he had said that only 2 persons attacked. This is a contradiction. Many a times I have seen lawyers arguing before the courts saying that you please look at his evidence now. You look at the statement but to the doctor where he has said that 2 persons, here he says 5 persons. There is a contradiction. Yes, there is a contradiction. But the contradiction has not been duly proved is the point. Contradiction means you have to contradict. Mere contradiction will not be taken note of by the court unless the contradiction is put to the witness concerned. So you have to put this to the witness, namely the injured, and call upon him to explain. This is in tune with the principles of natural justice. So if you do not do this, if you do not cross-examine that particular witness about this statement, then it will not be available for you to argue before the court, requesting the court to look at the action register. This is the statement, and this is the statement made here. This is not available for you. So if the man dies, as I told you, this is the dying declaration. The consciousness, unconsciousness is a matter to be tested by you by cross-examining the doctor from out of the injuries, etc. So the opinion of the doctor need not be accepted simply. Then comes at the end, he gives opinion about the nature of the injuries. That is, he says that this is lacerated, this is incised, and this injury is a contusion, and this injury is abrasion, and this injury is a contusion with abrasion. He gives all opinion about the nature of the injury which were found on the externally on the body. These matters can be challenged by you during cross-examination. How are you going to do is one of the subjects which I am going to cover today. This. Then he gives opinion. As I pointed out already, he gives further opinion that these injuries would have been caused at or about the time. So the time of the injuries, the age of the injuries is also elicited by means of opinion from the doctor. If you feel that the time as stated by the doctor is from the correct time, you can challenge this also. I do not suggest you that every opinion given by the doctor is to be challenged. Wherever it is so required, you have to challenge. So the time of the injury can also be challenged by you if there is any requirement for that also, if there is absolute necessity for you to do so. This is second opinion. Then third opinion he gives is that these injuries could have been caused by this kind of weapon. So this part can also be challenged by you if need be. Suppose he says that the injury would have been caused by a sharp-edged weapon like Arwal, whereas the injury is only a contusion. You need not accept the opinion of the doctor. You have to cross-examine and you have to say that this injury would not have been caused by a sharp-edged weapon. This should be your suggestion. For that, you have to rely on the certain medical authoritative books on forensic medicine and confront the doctor also. Without challenging this and without confronting, I don't think that it will be available for you to argue at the time of argument that this injury would not have been caused. If it is so obvious that the opinion is wrong, then you can argue even without any challenge. Suppose the injury is, as I pointed out, if the injury is a contusion, whereas the weapon shown in court is so sharp-edged, and according to the victim, the sharp-edged portion was used to cut him, that will not cause any contusion at all. In such an event, even without cross-examination, you are at liberty to argue before the court that this injury would not have been caused in the manner alleged by him. So this is the way in which you have to cross-examine the doctor in respect of the action register. Now let us say the man dies. The body goes for post-mortem. Now the doctor notices the injuries on the body externally and records them. They prepare one notes known as post-mortem notes. When the post-mortem is being conducted, there is a fixed format prescribed by the government which is used by the doctors, where they make entries spontaneously. What are the injuries? They start from head, go up to leg, or they start from leg, they go up to the head. They notice all the external injuries first and record them. Then they open the body. They open almost the entire trunk, neck, and the head, including skull. They open. They find out the internal injuries pertaining to three systems of the human body mostly. There are also other systems. There are three major systems about which also you should have knowledge. The first one is the circulatory system, then respiratory, then neuro, that is pertaining to nervous system. Pertaining to head of this system, namely nervous system is the brain. So it directs all the nerves in the body to function in a particular way. So the head of this system is brain. Similarly, the head of the circulatory system is the heart. It controls the entire circulation of blood in the human body. So heart is the head of that system. Then the next one is the respiratory system. The head of the system is lungs. So these are the three very important major systems in the human body. I do not say that the other systems are not as important as these systems are. Every system, every part, every organ in the human body is very important for human living. Like we cannot say that the liver is not required. Liver is very important. That functions in a different system. Digestive system, you take digestive system commencing from mouth, it goes up to the anus. So that system, like that, there are so many systems, but for our discussion, for our forensic knowledge to do criminal cases, mainly we are concerned with these three systems. So the doctor gives notice of the external injuries, then he opens the body, notices the internal injuries in the body, including the presence of the collection of blood in the abdominal cavity and also in the thoracic cavity. Thoracic cavity, and for the younger members of the bar who do not have so much of this thing in this field, I want to tell you what is thoracic cavity and what is abdominal cavity. I will say that. I will come weeks later. So they notices, the doctor notices all the internal injuries in the body. Then he makes a record in the postmortem notes. Then he removes, the doctor removes the brain and cuts it and finds the cut section of the brain to see whether there were any internal injuries in the brain and whether there are any blood collection or edema in the brain. He notices everything so far brain is concerned. Then similarly he comes to the heart, he comes to the neck. Then in the neck the doctor notices whether the hyoid bone is intact, whether there is any fracture to any of the cervical bones, and whether there is any injury to the major two blood vessels which carry blood to the brain and return the blood to the heart. Those two blood vessels are known as, one is jugular vein and the other one is carotid artery. This thing he sees. And after noticing the major injuries to the heart and the connected systems, he goes to the lungs. What are the injuries? They are in the lungs. He notices them. Then he goes to the abdominal cavity to see whether there is any injury to the stomach, whether there is any injury to small intestine, whether there is any injury to duodenum, whether there is any injury to the big intestine, large intestine, and bowel up to the anus. He tests all those things very thoroughly. If there is any collection of fluid in the abdominal cavity, that also the doctor notices. Then the doctor also notices whether there was any splenic injury. Spleen is another important organ. If there is any injury to spleen, even if a person is just given a kick, very strong kick, then the spleen will get ruptured and a man will die out of that. Simple kick on the abdomen, I tell you, simple kick. But if by force, if the kick is given on the abdomen, and when the man did not expect that a kick, he suffers splitting of this organ. And from the spleen, there is profuse bleeding, which causes the death. So that we call a splenic injury, whether there was any splenic injury. That also the doctor notices. Then the doctor comes to the uterus. If the body is that of a woman, the doctor sees whether there is a uterus, whether there was any fetus, etc. He notices. If there is a fetus, he takes out the fetus and examine the fetus also to see whether there is any injury, etc. Then he goes up to, then he sees the peripheral injuries, legs and heart, testes. So like this, a doctor is expected to examine thoroughly, not only to note down the external injuries on the human body, commence from head to leg, but also to see all the internal injuries inside the body, and also to note down the condition of the internal organs. Say, for example, whether the organs were shown sign of decomposition, or there is virtually any decomposition of any of the internal organs, that also the doctor is expected to note and write in the postmortem notes. And the doctor is expected to remove the visceral organs. You know what is viscera? Digestive system. He has to remove the visceral organs and some portion of liver and some portion of the kidney and all that. That also the doctor is expected to send to the forensic lab, that is forensic medicine, not forensic medicine department, that is forensic science department, there for examination to see whether there was any poison, to find out whether there was any other substance like acid or food materials even. So for that purpose, it is again sent to the doctor. There is yet another examination known as histopathological examination. Histopathological examination is normally conducted to find whether a particular injury is antemortem or postmortem. The doctor notes down only the antemortem injuries. To my knowledge, doctors do not worry to mention about the postmortem injuries. In my view and in my perception, it is desirable that the doctors note down even the postmortem injuries. Many doctors, though the experts in forensic medicine do that, many doctors who are not experts in forensic medicine, they do not do that. So my humble view is that all the injuries, whether postmortem or antemortem, should be invariably mentioned, noted down by the doctor. This is the next thing that they do. So after completing all these formalities, the doctor gives opinion regarding the cause of death. This opinion falls under Section 45 of the Evidence Act. So when he comes to the court, he supports the opinion. You have to challenge that opinion if it is required. Don't have the impression that in every case you have to cross-examine the doctor. In my experience of about 25 years, I have said no cross to many doctors. So, but there is an impression, even some of my friends who are sitting by my side when I was doing the cases used to ask me, what is this? You are not asked any question during cross-examination. So I have told them there is no need to cross-examine. Even some judges, even asked me, trial court judges, what is this? You are not putting any question. What question should I put? Then they themselves will supply some answer, some hints to us, clue. How you tell the doctor that these injuries would not even cause in the manner and time and manner it is alleged by the prosecution. Put that suggestion. So to satisfy the judge, I want to put that suggestion, though I was not for it. I tell you, friends, that a cross-examination of a doctor is with a purpose. It is not an empty formality that you should, first of all, keep in your mind. For example, if the doctor says that by a single cut with an aruval, the right hand of the injured was amputated. He says, by single cut, the hand was amputated. The injured comes to the court and says, yes, it was single cut, hand was amputated. What is the cross-exam that you could do in the matter? Can you say that this injury would not have been caused by a cut with aruval? Could you say that? No, you cannot say that. Could you say that the man would not have cut him at all? That is irrelevant to the doctor. Doctor does not say that as to who caused the injury. Doctor only say that this injury would have been caused by a single cut. If you got any doubt about that, then only you have to cross-examine the doctor. If you do not have any doubt about that, if you concede to this fact, when you have got other very good points in your favor, you do not labor much on that. And in my view, it will not be ethical on your part also legally to ask any question challenging the doctor for the sake of challenge. So, doctor, don't ask any doctor unnecessarily. I'll give you one small illustration as to what I experienced in one of the cases as a judge. It happened in Chennai. A girl was in her workplace. One fellow, the accused, came there. So some dispute that they are not very relevant. He came to the spot. He poured the kerosene on her. Poured acid, concentrated acid on her. So then that fellow fled away from the scene of occurrence. The bystanders took her to the nearby clinic. The doctor there, with a view to give first aid to the patient, because there was a direction by the Honorable Supreme Court, that in 1996, Paramanand Kattara, a very senior lawyer of the Supreme Court, filed a public interest litigation before the Honorable Supreme Court. That is a reported case, Paramanand Kattara, wherein the Honorable Supreme Court was directed that no doctor should hesitate or refuse to give treatment to a person who is brought to him. Though it is a medical legal case, so some of the doctors used to say, go to the police station, get a police memo, then come here. This practice was deprecated when the Honorable Supreme Court has issued a direction, and this direction is now known to all the doctors almost. And the direction is that the doctors should immediately treat the patient, give first aid. In this case, the doctor gave first aid. He gave water wash, then removed used some sponge like that and removed the acid, then asked her to be taken to the doctor, to the hospital. Then she was taken to the government hospital where she underwent treatment. Unfortunately, she succumbed to the acid thrown injuries. Now, this doctor who gave the first aid was in the box. Now, the lawyer started cross-examining him. Brothers, believe me, it is a reported case. One full day, the doctor was cross-examined with reference to the hospital. Question was whether it is a private hospital, whether who are the directors, what is the working hours of the hospital. Like that, the doctor was cross-examined for the whole day. At the end, the doctor believed that the cross-examination was over. But to his dismay, the lawyer said that many more questions are to be asked. Then the doctor was asked to come again. The next day he came. Then today, the next day, the questions were all about his educational qualification and all that. Like, where did you do your MBBS? Where did you do your MD? You did your course in the government college, but why did not you join a government service? Why did you join this private hospital like that? It went on for the whole day, 2 days. The doctor was grilled like anything, but no question was relevant. The judge was a mere mute spectator. He did not prevent the lawyer from asking these questions. 2 days it went on. So ultimately, the man was convicted. The appeal came up before us, before a division bench headed by me. Then, fortunately, the lawyer who cross-examined appeared before us. I asked him, show me one question or one answer that you elicited, which will help you today. You show me. You cross-examined over many pages. It runs to many pages. So he was not able to point out even a single line in the deposition of the doctor in favor of him. What did he do? The doctor said only two things. That I gave water wash, I cleaned, sent her. For the 2 days cross-examination, therefore, doctor, please friends, the doctors come to the court only to help us. The doctors come there as experts because we are not experts in forensic medicine. Therefore, kindly don't harass them. And if the questions are not required, don't ask any questions. Say boldly, say no crush to the doctor. Okay, this I learned from Mr. Vrudajalam Reddiar. And he used to say no crush in many cases. So this is how the doctor come to records everything, come to the court to give opinion. Now the opinion is to be challenged. What is the opinion in the postmortem? He says that the injuries are antemortem, that you may have to challenge. The doctor says that these injuries would have been caused in such a way that may have to be challenged by you. The time of death, the doctor says, that may have to be challenged by you. And the cause of death, that is very, very important, that may have to be challenged by you. How to challenge all these things? How medical evidence becomes very, very important? And I was referring to you about the three major systems in the human body. I'll give a brief introduction about these three systems in the human body, and that will be very useful for us for us when we are going to discuss about the cause of death. Now, what are the systems? Now, number one is nervous system. That is the neuro department, nervous system. The head is the brain. Now, the brain sends messages to various organs or cells of the body through the spinal cord. From the spinal cord, the nerves, the branches off, and they go up to every part of the body, leg, both the legs, both the hands, every part of the human body. It serves a main purpose, that is, it controls the functioning, the brain controls the functioning of every organ in the human body and every functioning of the human being. Your thinking is controlled by the brain. Your activity is controlled by the brain. That is why we say in criminal cases, whether there was any mens rea, whether there was any actus reus. Mens rea means what your mind thinks. And actus reus means what your body does as it was driven by mens rea. So mens rea and actus reus, both are required for an offense to be made out as per IPC, and that is not our subject today. So your brain controls the not only your thinking, every activity of the human being, including the functioning of every organ in the human body. If the brain stops functioning, then all organs as follow of action will stop functioning, man will die. So brain is the head of this system. Now you go to the next system, that is circulatory system. Circulatory system means the blood is carried through the by the blood through the blood vessel to the various parts of the human body. Now, what is the purpose of this circulation? And for that, we should also know about the respiratory system, of which lungs is the head. What is the function of the lungs? Now, during this COVID-19, we are talking so much about collapse of the lungs. Yes, due to this COVID-19. So what is the function of the lungs? Let us know it. Now, the lungs enlarges like a balloon, and it inhales, that it draws air into it. When we inhale, lot of amount of air from the atmosphere goes into our lung. How the lung functions? Lung functions because of the duodenum. Duodenum is nothing but a screen like, which separates the thoracic cavity and the abdominal cavity. Abdominal cavity is where the digestive system, kidney and all other things, lower part, let us say that is the lower part. Abdomen means abdomen, you know, that is the lower part. Thorax means chest. Abdomen means below the chest. So what separates these two cavities, thoracic cavity, that is chest, and abdominal cavity, that is the abdomen, is the that works. That what the it does is that it functions, it moves upwards and downwards, and as a result, the lung also functions. Now, when the lung enlarges its full strength, then lot of air goes into the lungs. Then what happens after the air has gone into the lungs? What happened there? Now, already in the lungs, the capillaries of the blood vessels are readily waiting for the air to come into the lungs. The moment the air goes into the lungs, you see, you just, for the test, you just inhale and exhale. It takes few seconds. Within this period, lot of activities go on in the lungs. So when the air goes inside, what happens? The blood vessels, which are already there, release the carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is carried by red blood corpuscles, RBCs. We say that RBCs. We also say that when RBC count koranju pochunla solluvom. So RBC, WBC are warriors, fighters. White blood corpuscles are warriors, fighters. Avanga da fight pandranga. Ipo vandu human body la vandu, suppose some foreign bacteria or virus enters in the body, one and the adathukku immediately all the WBCs will go there. And we know that there is another thing, I think that it is antigen and all that. They fight and kill the virus or kill the bacteria when they enter. Major thing when the bacteria and virus, they kill them. That is a different functioning. Leave it apart. Now come to the RBCs. RBC carry the carbon dioxide from the heart. Eppadi? Carbon dioxide, all right, I'll come to that. I'll make it very easier for you to understand. Now, after releasing in the lungs, one RBC releases one atom of one molecule of carbon dioxide, that is CO2. It releases, it goes into the lungs in the air. Then from the air, it captures one molecule of oxygen, that is O2. O2 means oxygen. That oxygen molecule is captured by the red blood corpuscle in the blood. Then after catching so much of oxygen from the air in the lungs, it returns to the heart. It returns to the heart through a vein known as pulmonary vein. Through the pulmonary vein, it returns. It comes to the heart now. Now, from the heart, it has to go out. Heart pumps. The moment it is pumped out, then the blood that is RBCs carrying oxygen goes out of the heart. It goes to various parts of the body. Let us say it goes to the leg. It goes in the main artery. Then it branches off. Then small arteries. Finally, it reaches the capillary. You take the leg. So the major blood vessel in the thigh is known as femoral artery. Femoral artery. It is a blood like you see my finger, thumb. This much of size is a femoral artery. Blood goes through that. Then branches off. Finally, it goes to the capillaries. Capillaries are the minute blood vessels. So from the capillary at the end, from the RBC, what does it do? It supplies the oxygen. It supplies the oxygen to the cell, to a particular cell in the flesh or in the that part of the body. It supplies the oxygen. It gives the oxygen there. Then already the carbon dioxide is available there. How carbon dioxide is available? The oxygen is supplied there. Then the oxygen is burnt in that particular area. In the entire body, every fraction of the second, burning takes place. That is, oxygen which is supplied, we inhale the air, oxygen is separated. It goes to the heart. From the heart, it goes to the various parts of the human body. There, the oxygen goes to the blood cells. Human cells. Flesh, bone, everywhere. There, it is burnt. When it is burnt with the carbon, that is, carbohydrate is also already there, that is supplied by the plasma in the blood. It carries the whatever we eat, it is carried. So it is... burnt there, and carbon dioxide is produced. Because of the burning, there is body temperature. Always our body maintains some kind of temperature. It should not exceed 98.6 degrees of Fahrenheit. If it is in centigrade, it should not exceed 37.5. 37.5 is a normal human body temperature. This temperature is maintained because of the burning of oxygen with carbon and production of carbon dioxide in our body. Everywhere it is produced. Then after the carbon dioxide is produced there, the red blood corpuscle catches that carbon dioxide. Then through the circulation, it comes back to the heart now again. Now, from the heart, again, it is pumped out. It goes through the pulmonary artery to the lungs. Brothers, the difference between artery and vein is, artery is the blood vessel which supplies the blood to various parts of the human body, artery. It carries oxygen. It carries oxygen, passes the oxygen through it, artery. Vein means it returns the blood to the heart. It returns the blood to the heart. That it carries the blood RBCs with carbon dioxide. So this is like a circle. That is why it is a circulatory system. It goes in one route. It is always one way. In arteries, blood flows from out of the heart. It goes to various parts of the body. Then vein returns the blood from the body, from various parts of the body to the heart. You understand that? So there should not be any mixing of these two. Artery and vein on the other side. Now, this I am telling you about some basic idea about the human anatomy, because this will be useful. I am going to discuss about that also, as to how this artery and vein plays a vital role. But so far as, I have already told you that the function of the artery is to carry and supply blood from the heart to various parts of the body, and the function of the vein is to carry, to return the blood from various parts of the body to the heart. Then from the heart, the blood with the carbon dioxide has to go only through vein, is it not? But there is a change there alone. From heart to lungs, the blood, we call it as bad blood. But in the blood, there is no bad blood or good blood. Blood is blood. If it is bad, then man will die. So for our understanding, we say that when the blood, in your school day, we were said, சுத்த ரத்தம் அசுத்த ரத்தம் அது மாதிரி ஒண்ணுமே கிடையாது எல்லாமே சுத்தம் தான் ஸோ கார்பன் டை ஆக்சைடு இருந்ததுன்னா அசுத்த ரத்தம் ஆக்சிஜன் இருக்கிறது சுத்த ரத்தம்னு சும்மா ஒரு அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்டிங்காக சொன்னது அதை நம்ம மனசில் வச்சுக்கிட்டு இருக்கோம் அதை முதல்ல மறந்துருங்க அது அந்த காலத்தில் சொன்னது இப்போ நவ் இந்த லங்ஸுக்கு மாத்திரம் போது பாருங்க பிளட் ஸோ ஃப்ரம் தி ஹார்ட் கார்பன் டை ஆக்சைடு வித் இன் த பிளட் இஸ் டேக்கன் டு த லங்ஸ் ஹியர் அலோன் திஸ் தி வெசல் இஸ் நோன் அஸ் not artery, you know, not vein, it is artery, pulmonary artery. Pulmonary artery is very important. Postmortem, there are many things I can tell you. Pulmonary artery, please kindly note. Pulmonary artery is the artery which carries, for our understanding, I say bad blood from heart. That is impure blood, we can say. No, it is not even impure, it is pure blood only. Carrying carbon dioxide from the heart to lungs. Here alone, ஒரே ஒரு டிஸ்டிங்ஷன் நல்லா பார்த்துக்கோங்க ஹியர் அலோன் இன் தி வெயின் தி ஆக்சிஜன் இஸ் கேரிட் இன் தி ஆர்டரி கார்பன் டை ஆக்சைடு இஸ் கேரிட் இந்த இடத்துல ஒரே ஒரு சேஞ்ச் ஸோ திஸ் வெயின் இஸ் நோன் அஸ் பல்மனரி வெயின் அண்ட் தி ஆர்டரி இஸ் நோன் அஸ் பல்மனரி ஆர்டரி ப்ளீஸ் நோ திஸ் ஆல்சோ ஓகே ஸோ திஸ் இஸ் த சிஸ்டம் பை விச் திஸ் சர்க்குலேட்டரி சிஸ்டம் ஃபங்க்ஷன்ஸ் திஸ் இஸ் அ வே இன் விச் திஸ் respiratory system function. You know the system, major systems now. Now, out of the injuries or out of some other cause, a man dies. Okay? That case comes before the court. Now, cause of death. Doctor said that this was the cause of death. How a man dies? If you know as to what is the concept of death, for the purpose of IPC, then you will easily understand what I am going to say now. Here, if you see the definition for death in the IPC, it is not defined except saying that death means death of a human being, that's all. Just see the definition in the IPC. What is death? Death means death of a human being. That's all he stated. And see section 46. Death. The word death denotes the death of a human being unless the contrary appears from the context. This is the only definition. Death. Death means death of a human being. How a human being dies, out of what cause, that is also important. Now, you broadly saying there are three causes for death. Suppose there is failure of the nervous system, that is the nervous system, central nervous system, we call it as also. Suppose brain, spinal cord, and all the nerves. If man dies out of failure of this system, that death is known as death due to syncope. Please understand this. I am going to very elaborately deal with that. So this is known as death due to syncope. I have already explained to you as to what is the central nervous system. If death is on account of the failure of this system, that if the brain stops functioning, man dies. So we call nowadays brain death. We say that there is a brain death. So brain death leads to the stoppage of other organs, other functions, man dies. So this brain death is known as syncope. If the man dies out of the non-functioning or stoppage of functioning by the brain, then this death is known as death due to syncope. Please understand, make a note of the syncope. If a man dies out of the failure of the central nervous system, death is due to coma. I am sorry, very extremely sorry. I have, out of my anxiety, I have wrongly used the word syncope. Coma, death due to coma. Now go to the next stage. Syncope. Syncope is stoppage of functioning of the heart. That is failure of the circulatory system. That is syncope, death due to syncope. If the central nervous system fails and the man dies out of that, death is due to coma. That is failure of functioning of the brain. Then if there is death due to the stoppage of heart, heart stops functioning, that death is known as syncope. Okay, you know, the broadly you know all these things. Then you suppose there is failure of functioning of the lungs, this system, that is the respiratory system, there is failure, that death is known as death due to asphyxia. Asphyxia. In the postmortem certificates, you will find mostly in cases of strangulation, in cases of hanging, the doctors will say that death due to asphyxia. So asphyxia means stoppage of functioning of the lungs. Syncope means stoppage of functioning of heart. Suppose, as it happened in the case of our former chief minister, there occurred sudden stoppage, sudden cardiac arrest. Then man dies. So we call it as sudden heart attack. சொல்லுவோம் ஹார்ட் அட்டாக்ல செத்து போயிட்டார், நல்லா தான் நடந்தே போயிட்டு இருந்தாரு, புசுக்குன்னு உட்கார்ந்தாரு, ஹார்ட் அட்டாக்ல செத்து போயிட்டார். வாட் இஸ் ஹார்ட் அட்டாக்? ஹார்ட்டை போய் யாரும் அடிக்கிறாங்களா இல்லை ஹார்ட் யாரும் அட்டாக் பண்ணுதா? நோ, ஹார்ட் நெவர் அட்டாக் எனிபடி. ஹார்ட் இஸ் நாட் அட்டாக். ஹார்ட் ஸ்டாப் ஃபங்க்ஷனிங் சடன்லி ஃபார் அன்னோன் காசஸ், ஃபார் அன்னோன் காசஸ் ஹார்ட் சடன்லி ஸ்டாப் ஃபங்க்ஷனிங், தட் டெத் இஸ் நோன் அஸ் சின்கோப், டெத் டியூ டு சின்கோப். ஸோ தீஸ் ஆர் தி த்ரீ வேஸ் இன் விச் மேன் டைஸ். So, though in the IPC, the death, what is death? The term death is not defined. Death is defined only as death of a human being. That's all is defined. How the man dies, when the man dies, for that, you have to go only to the forensic medicine. You should know that these are the three systems. Other systems also fail. The other systems will not result in death immediately. Suppose there is failure of kidney. What will happen? That will not cause the death immediately. That will have impact or effect on the other systems, like any one of these three systems. Then only man will die. Suppose there is a liver functioning stops due to some injury or like cancer, etc. Man will not die immediately. After, have you seen any patient with the liver cancer dying immediately? No. He will live with the cancer for many more years. But it will have impact. When it touches upon the functioning of the lungs, when it touches upon the functioning of the heart or brain, the nervous system, then only that will lead to death. These three causes for death is very important for you to know, because the time of death is decided by this only, by these three causes only. I'll tell you how. Now you take the case of strangulation or hanging. What happens when the neck is constricted or mouth, when the nose and mouth are closed, there is no air going into the lungs. So when there is no air going into the lungs, the lung stops functioning because it cannot do anything. As I told you, the RBCs are waiting there to take oxygen to the heart, then to all the entire human body. It is waiting. On one side, carbon dioxide carrying RBCs through that pulmonary artery are pushing into the lungs. On one side, the other do not return at all. Why they do not return? They are not able to catch oxygen. So as a result, what happens? There is congestion. Doctor will notice congestion of heart. Congestion of heart means enormous collection of blood in the lungs. That is the color of the lung will become so reddish. Heart irukku heart idula paathirupinga and color enna irukonu. When the blood on one side, as I told you, with carbon dioxide, blood is just pushing into the lungs. On the other side, equally, the blood should carry, the RBC should carry oxygen, go out. But they do not go, they remain there because waiting for oxygen to come. Oxygen is not coming because nose is closed. So as a result, the lungs becomes contused. Not congested, I'm sorry, congested. Lot of congestion. Congestion means, traffic congestion. Traffic and then வந்து நெருக்கிறது அந்த மாதிரி கன்ஜெஷன் மீன்ஸ் பிளட் நிறைய வந்து 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 ஒரு சைடில் வந்துகிட்டே இருக்கு அந்த இம்பியூர் பிளட் நம்ம சொன்னது கார்பன் டை ஆக்சைடோட வந்து ஒரு சமம் உள்ளே வந்துகிட்டே இருக்கு அது வந்து ஆக்சிஜன் அது கார்பன் டை ஆக்சைடை வெளியில் விட முடியலை ஒரு சைடில் ஏற்கனவே வந்து வெயிட் பண்ணிட்டு இருக்கிறது அப்படியே வெயிட் பண்ணுது தே ஆர் நாட் ஏபிள் டு கேரி ஆக்சிஜன் தேர்ஃபோர் தேர் இஸ் கன்ஜெஷன் தேர் இஸ் ஹெவி டிராஃபிக் இன் த லங்ஸ் ஸோ வாட் ஹேப்பன்ஸ் ஆர் அல்டிமேட்லி தேர் இஸ் நான் சப்ளை of oxygen to the body cells. இப்போ பிரெயினுக்கு போக வேண்டியது வந்து ஆக்சிஜன் போக மாட்டேங்குது இப்போ வாட் ஹேப்பன்ஸ் தி செல்ஸ் இன் த பிரெயின் ஸ்டார்ட் டையிங் தி செல்ஸ் இன் த பிரெயின் ஸ்டார்ட் டையிங் இஃப் த செல்ஸ் இன் த பிரெயின் ஸ்டார்ட் டையிங் தென் தி பிரெயின் வில் நாட் ஃபங்க்ஷன் இஃப் த பிரெயின் டஸ் நாட் ஃபங்க்ஷன் ஆஸ் அ ரிசல்ட் ஹார்ட் ஆல்சோ ஸ்டாப் ஃபங்க்ஷனிங் இப்போ ஹார்ட் எப்போ நிற்கிதோ அப்போ தான் சார் டெத்து இப்போ டாக்டர்கள் வந்து பார்த்தோன்னே என்ன பார்ப்பாங்க உடனே ஆள் செத்து விட்டாரா என்னங்கிறதுக்கு பல்ஸை பிடிச்சி பார்ப்பாங்க தென் தே வில் சி தி ஹார்ட் பீட் இந்த ஹார்ட் பீட்டு நின்றணும் இந்த பல்ஸ் இன்னும் சுத்தமாக இருக்காது ஜீரோ ஆகிடும் ஏன்னா ஹார்ட் ஃபங்க்ஷன் பண்ணால் தான் பல்ஸ் ரேட் வரும் தேட் டினோட்ஸ் தி ஆக்சுவல் டெத் ஆஃப் த பர்சன் for the purpose of IPC section 299-300-304A. Correct? So, ultimately, the man dies out of the stoppage of heart. So, initially, in the case of strangulation, what happens is, first there is stoppage of functioning of the respiratory system, which leads to the stoppage of the nervous system. Which again leads to the stoppage of the functioning of the circulatory system. Therefore, heart stops. The moment the heart stops functioning, man dies. This is the way in which death occurs. So in all cases, the time of death is decided based on the stoppage, the time at which the heart functioning stops. Okay, that is the actual time of death. So when the doctor says that death would have occurred this much of time, that much of time before, after, etc., etc., you have to cross-examine the doctor. Suppose it is a case of injury to brain, injury to head. Death may or may not occur immediately. Because when there is injury to brain, what will happen? On one side, lung is functioning, oxygen is supplied, but there is one part affected in the brain, the corresponding part becomes functionless in the body. As a result, what happens? The man goes to coma. Coma la irukarnu solluvoma illaya? Coma la irpar. The man will go to coma. Then the brain cells will die and the brain death vandrum. But heart will be functioning for some more time due to artificial inducement. Appa heart mathram function panna vechikitte irupanga. அதுதான் அந்த இதெல்லாம் கொடுத்து கொடுக்குறாங்களே இல்லையா காற்றை வச்சு வாயில் வச்சு ஊதுறது அதான் அந்த மிஷின்லாம் கண்டுபிடிச்சிக்காங்களே அதை வச்சு காற்றை வச்சு ஊதிக்கிட்டே இருப்பாங்க ஒரு சைடில் வென்டிலேட்டர் போட்டு காற்றை ஊதிக்கிட்டே இருக்கிறது உள்ள இழுக்கிறது ஊதுறது இதுதான் வென்டிலேட்டர் இப்போ நான் சொன்னது வெண்டி லங்ஸ் ஸ்டார்ட் சஃபர்ஸ் ஃபங்க்ஷன் ஃபுல் இட்ஸ் ஃபுல் ஃபங்க்ஷனிங் என்ன பண்ணுவாங்க ஒன்று இந்த வென்டிலேட்டர் போகும் முதல்ல ஆக்சிஜனை மாத்திரம் கொடுத்து பார்க்குறது ஏன்னா கார் காற்றுலேருந்து அதை பிரிக்கிறதுக்கு ரொம்ப கஷ்டம் கத்துறாங்க ஆக்சிஜன் மாத்திரம் கொடுக்கறது If that also doesn't work, they go for this method, ventilator. Ventilator actually pushes the oxygen into the lungs and it sucks the carbon dioxide. Put to oodi, adhuve pannikitte irukku. Aga, instead of lungs functioning inside, this machine functions outside. This is a ventilator system. So ipdi than the correlate agudhu death. So for our understanding, let us know that actual death occurs only when the heart stops functioning. Puringla, that is ultimately the death due to syncope. Ipo death la innum irukku innor major classification, somatic death and cellular death. Please friends, I don't think whether you are interested in knowing all these things. I am taking you some in an abstract sense.
They're keenly watching, sir. They're very keenly watching.
Okay, this may be somewhat boring, but it will be very interesting also if you read the books, you will know all these things. So death, first classification of death is two. One is somatic death, S-O-M-A-T, somatic death. Next one is cellular death. All along, by the failure of all these three systems, I was telling you about somatic death. Somatic death has got three causes. One, somatic death due to syncope, somatic death due to coma, somatic death due to asphyxia. That I have already told you. Now, what is cellular death? இப்ப யூட எக்ஸ்பீரியன்ஸ் திஸ். செத்ததுக்கு பிறகும் பாடியில வந்து டெம்பரேச்சர் இருக்கும். எப்படி அது? மேன் டைஸ் பிகாஸ் ஆல் த த்ரீ சிஸ்டம்ஸ் ஆல்ரெடி ஃபெயில்டு, ஹார்ட் ஹேஸ் ஸ்டாப்ட், ஃபைனலி ஹார்ட் ஹேஸ் ஸ்டாப்ட், தென் ஸ்டில் தெர் இஸ் எ பாடி டெம்பரேச்சர். இன்னும் உதாரணம் சொன்னா, சப்போஸ் இன் அன் ஆக்சிடென்ட், ஒரு விரல் ஒரு மிஷினில் விட்டு விரல் துண்டு போட்டு போச்சுன்னு வைங்க, டாக்டர் என்ன சொல்லுவாங்க? You remove that finger immediately, that chopped off finger, you remove it immediately in a plastic la pottu jaakra odane kondu vaangama. Within 3 hours, if it is brought to the hospital, they will fix it again, then on the viral nu utti eppadi adu. So the moment it is chopped off from your body, the cells in that should die, but they do not die, because without oxygen the cells can live for a maximum time of 3 hours. In the cell irukkile and idukulla iruka cells na the flesh ukulla apdiye mainunda poi kadasi avara cell, the human cells will survive without oxygen for 3 hours. Okay, so only 3 hours, whatever with the available oxygen there, they will be burning, they will be living. To oxygen get exhausted, it will take slowly 3 hours. அதனால தான் சொல்றேன், என்ன 3 hours குள்ள நீ கொண்டு வந்துட்டீங்கன்னா அந்த செல்லு செத்து போகாது. செல்ஸ் இன் த ஃபிங்கர், சாப்ட் ஆஃப் ஃபிங்கர் வில் நாட் டை. கொண்டு வந்து உடனே ஒட்ட வச்சு பிளட்டை மறுபடியும் சர்க்குலேஷன் மெயின்டைன் பண்ணிட்டாங்கன்னா செல் வில் சர்வை, செல் வில் நாட் டை. ஒன்ஸ் செல் டைஸ், தென் யூ கேனாட் கிவ் லைஃப் டு இட். அப்புறம் நீ ஒட்ட வச்சிங்கன்னா அவ்வளோதான், முடிஞ்சு போச்சு, அது ஒன்றும் ஒட்டாக்க முடியாது, டைம் ஆயிடுச்சுன்றவாங்க, செத்து போச்சுன்னா தூக்கி விட்டு வேண்டிய வரல. 3 hours குள்ள கொண்டு வந்துட்டா அதில் வந்து பிளட் அந்த அது அது வந்து அந்த செல் வந்து செத்துருக்காது. உடனே ஒட்ட வச்சு மறுபடியும் பிளட்டை சர்க்குலேட் பண்ணி ஆக்சிஜன் போயிடும், பிளாஸ்மா போயிடும், எல்லாம் போயிடும், ஆளு அந்த விரல் பிழைச்சிக்கும். புரியுதா? இப் இந்த ஹியூமன் பாடி நோ திஸ் பேசிக் திங், இஃப் எ செல் டைஸ் அவுட் ஆஃப் எனி ரீசன், ஃபார் எனி ரீசன், யூ கெனாட் கிவ் லைஃப் டு தி செல் அட் ஆல். செத்துனா செத்துது தான். தென் ஃப்ரெஷ் செல்ஸ் கேன் பி கிரியேட்டட். இப்போ உதாரணத்துக்கு சொல்கிறோம், சொன்னீங்கன்னா இப்போ லங்ஸில் வந்து சாரி இந்த லிவரில், இப்போ சப்போஸ் வந்து லிவரில் வந்து கேன்சர் இருக்குன்னு வைங்க. ஸோ தி டாக்டர் பை மீன்ஸ் ஆஃப் சர்ஜிக்கல் ப்ரொசீஜர் வில் ரிமூவ் தட் போர்ஷன் ஆஃப் தி லிவர். அந்த லிவர் எடுத்துருவாங்க. எடுத்ததுக்கு அப்புறமும் தி செல்ஸ் வில் ஃபர்தர் ஃபார்ம் அண்ட் இட் வில் கெட் தி ஃபுல் ஷேப் ஆஃப் தி லிவர் எகெயின். இட் வில் கம் டு தி ஃபுல் ஷேப் பை க்ரோத். அதே மாதிரி இப்போ காலில் வந்து ஒரு காயம் பட்டுருச்சு உங்களுக்கு, suppose there is an injury on your leg, the cells will die on at that place because of non supply of blood etc. It will die. And the setu pathinga the patta patta urinju varum, setu pona cell pura patta patta urinju varum poidum, but the fresh cells will develop there and it will complete they will replace the place of the cells which died. So this is the way in which function. So cellular death, coming back to the topic, cellular death happens after the somatic death. So we are concerned for the purpose of IPC, we are concerned only with somatic death. That is the stoppage of the functioning of the heart is the actual death. Cellular death takes place within 3 hours after the somatic death. 3 மணி நேரம் அந்த செல் எல்லாம் உயிரோட இருக்கும். அதான் செல்லுலர் டெத். இது ஏன் இந்த செல்லுலர் டெத் பத்தி நான் சொல்றேன்? நான் சொல்லிட்டீங்களே, you already said that the death for the purpose of IPC means stoppage of heart. சொல்லிட்டீங்க. அப்புறம் எதுக்கு செல்லுலர் டெத் பத்தி ஒன்னு சொல்றீங்க? You may have that question. Answer is very simple. Because suppose the time of death is to be assessed. There is no eyewitness to the occurrence. Body is lying. There are injuries on the body. Time of death is to be assessed by the doctor. How it is done? So for 3 hours, cellular death takes place. So during the initial period of 3 hours, nothing happens in the body because body remains intact for 3 hours because the process of cellular death happens for 3 hours. Thereafter, after 3 hours, that is somewhere around 4 hours, the postmortem rigidity, rigor mortis starts to set in. நீங்க டாக்டர்கிட்ட கேட்பீங்க, மெடிக்கல் ஃபாரன்சிக் புக்லாம் படிச்சீங்கன்னா இட் வில் ஷோ இட் வில் டேக் 2.5 to 3 hours ஃபார் தி ரிகர் மார்டிஸ் டு செட் இன் இன் த ஹியூமன் பாடி அப்படின்னு படிச்சிருப்பீங்க. ஸோ த ரீசன் இஸ் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் தி சயின்ஸ் ஆஃப் இட். ஃபார் 2 to 3 hours, what happens in the human body after the somatic death is cellular death. There is no decomposition. Nothing of body is intact for at least 2 to 3 hours, depending upon the atmospheric condition, temperature, etc. Okay? So after the cellular death, that is which takes place after around, it is in a slow progress, it takes about 2 to 3 hours. Thereafter only, rigor mortis, body lividity, we call it as body lividity, it starts. That is, rigor mortis starts setting in after 2.5 to 3 hours in the human body. So this rigidity will remain in the body for 48 hours from the time of setting in. So 48 plus 3, 51. So அதுக்காக கரெக்டா 51 hours 1 minute கூட போயிச்சு அப்படின்னு கணக்கு பார்க்க கூடாது. These are only approximate. So there are so many other factors which also play some role, like temperature, constitution of the body, place where the body, whether the body is kept in the water or the body is kept on under the hot sun, sun rays irka nadalla potukangala. There are so many factors which are also to be taken into account. Science of forensic medicine is not perfect. It has not reached the perfection so far. Forensic medicine garu, it is not a perfect science. It is only an imperfect science, going by only approximation. Therefore, when I am time solradala correcta vandu 2.5 to 3 hours solren po 3 mani neram avanona posukku odane fraction of the second tap nu idu rigor mortis vandruma appadi illa. Rigor mortis will start setting in after the cellular death. Ella approximate, it will remain there for 48 hours. Thereafter, the body starts decomposition. Adhula vandu various stages of decomposition irukku. Adhula vandu enna na various stages abingiradha vandu nama innikku adhu enakku mudiyum nu enakku thonala. I will cover those things on a different date. Innikku summa I will give you only a broader idea about that. So idha base panni dhaan cause of time of death is decided. Time of death is calculated based on the condition of the body. First somatic death, then postmortem rigidity, that is rigor mortis, then decomposition, various stages of decomposition, adhu brain liquefaction, distension of body, adha body vandu appo bloat aagurudhu adhu or stage, brain liquefy aagur or stage, appo peeling up, cuticle formation of cuticles, cuticles na body blisters. அப்படியே மேலே வந்து இந்த கியூட்டிகல்ஸ் வந்து பிளிஸ்டர் ஃபார்ம் ஆகும். அப்படியே முட்டை முட்டை மாதிரி பார்த்தீங்கன்னா இந்த ஃபயர் கேஸ்லாம் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா தெரியும், அப்படியே கொப்பளிச்சு அப்படியே முட்டை முட்டையாக வந்துடும். அதுதான் வந்து ஃபார்மேஷன் ஆஃப் பிளிஸ்டர்ஸ். அந்த பிளிஸ்டர்ஸ் எப்போ வரும், அந்த பிளிஸ்டர்ஸுக்கு அப்புறம் வந்து ஆஃப்டர் த பிளிஸ்டர்ஸ் பீலிங் ஆஃப் ஸ்கின்னு அப்படியே மேலே வந்து மேல் தோல் மாத்திரம் அப்படியே அந்த மேலே இருக்கு பாருங்கள், அது மாத்திரம் அப்படியே உறிஞ்சி போயிடும். அது உறிஞ்சி போயிடுச்சுன்னா அதில் ரெண்டு இருக்குது, டெர்மிஸு எபிடெர்மிஸ் எல்லாம் இருக்கு. இந்த மேல் தோல் சும்மா சாதாரண புரிஞ்சு மேல் தோல் உறிஞ்சி அப்படியே வெளியேறணும் ஆயிரும் பாடி அது வர்றது. தென் மேகாட்ஸ் ஃபார்மேஷனாக மேகாட்ஸ் டெவலப் பண்ணுற மேகாட்ஸ், மேகாட்ஸ்னா என்ன புழு, மேகாட்ஸுங்கிறது புழுங்கிறது என்ன கேட்டீங்கன்னா, இப்போ நீங்கள் வந்து ஈ இருக்கு இல்லையா, ஈ பி அந்த ஈ வந்து வந்து இட் வில் லே எக், அதுக்கு வந்து உணவு தான். டெட் பாடியை பார்த்தீங்கன்னா அதை வாசனை வந்துச்சுனா உடனே வந்துடுது, அவுட் ஆஃப் ஸ்மெல் இட் வில் ரீச் த டெட் பாடி, அதில் இட் வில் ஸ்டார்ட் லேயிங் எக்ஸ் ஆன் த டெட் பாடி. அந்த எக்ஸ் வந்து அப்படியே டெவலப் ஆகி இட் வில் பிகம் மேகாட்ஸ், புழுக்களாக மாறும். இட் டிபெண்ட்ஸ் அப்பான் தி வெரைட்டி ஆஃப் தட் இன்செக்ட். சில இன்செக்டோடைய இது வந்து இத்தனை மணி நேரத்தில் முட்டை வரும், ஐம் சாரி இத்தனை மணி நேரத்தில் வந்து இந்த மேகாட்ஸ் வரும், இத்தனை மணி நேரத்தில் மேகாட்ஸில் ரெக்கம் முளைச்சி குறு பறந்து போயிடும், அப்புறம் ஈயா பறந்து போயிடும். இதுக்கு டைமிங் இருக்கு, ஒவ்வொன்றுக்கும் ஒரு டிஃப்ரென்ஸ் இருக்கு. ஸோ தி ப்ரெசன்ஸ் ஆஃப் மேகாட்ஸ், மேகாட்ஸ் வந்துடுச்சுன்னு வச்சுக்கோங்க, புழு வந்து அப்படியே இழந்துக்கிட்டு இருக்கு பாடியில்ன்னா, ஃப்ரம் அவுட் ஆஃப் தட் டைம் கேன் பி அசஸ்ட். அதுக்கும் ஒன்று ஒரு விஷயம் இருக்கு, தி மேகாட்ஸ் ஆர் டு பி கலெக்டட் அண்ட் சென்ட் டு தி ஃபார் எக்ஸாமினேஷன். அது வந்து இந்த வெட்டினரி யூனிவர்சிட்டிக்கு அனுப்பிவிட்டு தேர் தே கண்டக்ட் எக்ஸாமினேஷன், தே கிவ் தி ஏஜ் ஆஃப் தி மேகாட்ஸ், அதை வச்சும் டைம் ஆஃப் டெத்தை நீங்கள் டிசைட் பண்ணலாம். இஃப் அட் ஆல் யூ ஆர் இன்ட்ரெஸ்டட் இன் நோயிங் அபவுட் தி பீலிங் ஆஃப் ஸ்கின் அண்ட் அபவுட் தி ப்ரெசன்ஸ் ஆஃப் மேகாட்ஸ் அண்ட் தி போஸ்ட்மார்ட்டம் ரிஜிடிட்டி, ஆல் தீஸ் திங்ஸ், எ கிளாசிக் கேஸ் ஈஸ் தட் ஆஃப் தி டெத் ஆஃப் அன் அட்வொகேட் ஹூஸ் பாடி வாஸ் ஃப்ளோட்டிங் இன் ஆவடி ஆர் சம் லேக் இன் சென்னை. I think that it is nothing wrong reported case, there is nothing wrong in mentioning the name also. That relates to the death of the son of our very esteemed friend and a good lawyer, Mr. Shankarasubbu. His son's body, he was found missing and a complaint was made to the police investigated, you know very well. Then after some time the body was found floating in the nearby lake, body were taken from there. So investigation went on because of the judicial intervention. Postmortem was conducted by a team of doctors. Then the matter was referred to CBI for investigation. CBI people wanted to file a final report alleging that it was a case of suicide. Okay. Several, that report was opposed by the petitioner, namely the father of the deceased. It came up before us. In that, we have very elaborately dealt with this forensic medicine. Please, it's a classic case. How the time of death was decided, that peeling of entire from the entire body, we found that there was peeling of skin. எப்படி வந்தது? Suppose the body is floating on water and on one side water is so cool and therefore there will not be any decomposition so soon comparatively. The upper part of the body is exposed to sun. Anga body decomposition kuda irukum. Appo peeling off anga dhaan first varum. So all these things we have taken note of and we have written a very detailed judgment and ultimately we said that this would not have been a case of suicide. We doubted the opinion formed by the CBI and then we consulted the SID and referred the matter to them. And I am also told that the report came finally that it is not a case of suicide and the story projected by the CBI was rejected by one forensic expert by name Narayana, his name is Narayana Reddy from Andhra Pradesh. So please, all of you, if you are interested, please kindly read the judgment. It's a classic case. Now, having said all these things, so you are concerned with the time of death, you are concerned with the manner of death, and you are also concerned with the weapon that could have been possibly used. So these three areas. So I was under the mistaken impression that one forensic expert gave a lecture in this webinar and he said about all those things. So now Mr. Srinivas Raghavan tells me that it has not happened. Therefore, I will cover those areas. That is, how to assess the time of death. I will say very in a very detailed manner, because there is no time today. I'll give you in a very detailed manner, and how to challenge the cause of death, etc. Now, I am since the topic relates to the human offenses against the human body, I want my friends to know the importance of these three aspects: time of death, cause of death, and the manner of injury. How this thing plays a vital role. Please kindly come to section 299 of IPC. Let us take a case of death first. 299. Section 299, limb 2, speaks of intention of causing such bodily injury as is likely to cause death. First and foremost thing is that there has to be a death. You see the opening words of section 299. In every murder case, in every case relating to culpable homicide, in every case relating to accident 304A, there has to be a death of a human being. I already told you as to what is the death mean. What does it mean? I already told you. Now, you see the opening words of section 299. Whoever causes death by doing an act, whoever causes the death. Therefore, the death should have been caused by someone. That someone should be the accused before the court. So the prosecution is trying to prove that the man in court only caused the death. Okay? If you are able to show that he did not cause the death, then there is no further inquiry required at all. So to start with that, in every case you have to see whether he has caused the death or not. When can you say that he has not caused the death? There are two situations. Number one, if nobody says that he only caused the injuries, if no one says that he has only caused the injuries, then he will get acquitted because there is no proof that he caused the death. This is one situation. There is yet another situation where there are witnesses who say that he only caused the injuries. He only caused the injuries. Then the further examination would be whether these injuries have caused the death. Okay? There are two aspects in that. One, in the illustration which I gave, there is straight evidence that he did not do. Or there is no evidence at all that he did. All witnesses turn hostile. Nobody says that he only caused the injury. There is no difficulty, he will get acquitted. Suppose there are witnesses to say that he only caused these injuries. And if the court also is prepared to believe that story of the eyewitnesses, then the next inquiry is whether these injuries resulted in the death. Here only this forensic medicine or the medical evidence plays a vital role. So fundamentally, in every murder case, what is required of is that death should have been caused. By what manner? It may be due to strangulation. It may be due to injuries. It may be due to some other method also, by poison, etc. So death should have been caused by the accused. So there you can try to delink what? Though he has caused injuries, these injuries would not have caused the death. Here you can create a delink. If you are able to show that though there is evidence that he caused injuries, and those injuries would not have, possibly, you need not prove. You can only create a doubt as to whether these injuries would have caused the death or not. if you are able to create such kind of death doubt, then the prosecution will not be in a position to satisfy these opening words of section 219, whoever causes the death. This aspect you kindly keep in your mind. Then passing on further, secondly, whoever causes the death by doing an act with the intention of causing such bodily injury, limb number one, with the intention of causing death. If the intention could be gathered, intention of the accused could be gathered from various circumstances. If the intention is to cause the death, then no further inquiry is required. Suppose you are able to establish before the court that he never intended to cause the death, then the next examination, whether he intended to cause injury. Let us assume in the given case that it is a positive case of prosecution, or you are able to prove that the intention was only to cause such bodily injury. Okay, mere causing a bodily injury would be culpable homicide? No. What is the nature of the bodily injury? Such bodily injury as is likely to cause death. Please underline these words: likely to cause death. Here is a case where the prosecution is able to establish that he caused an injury, and that injury was caused with the intention of causing that injury. It is not by accident. That injury is, what is the nature of the injury? It is likely to cause death. So here also, brothers, legally you should understand one thing. So far as the intention is concerned, it is the test examiner is subjective, that is relating to the accused, whether the accused had the intention or not. So far a bodily injury is concerned, the test is objective. Objective means whether this bodily injury would be likely to cause death in the case of a man of ordinary health, not only to this person. Suppose this injury caused to anybody else, whether this would be likely to cause death is the test. So from out of this test, namely this objective test, namely whether the injury is likely to cause death, we decide whether it is culpable homicide or not. Here also you have got a point to urge. If you are able to show that this injury is not likely to cause death at all, if this injury is not likely to cause death at all, then it will not be culpable homicide. There will be no further examination. Okay? Now please understand, here from out of the nature of the injury, we have to accept or deny as to whether it is culpable homicide in terms of section 219. What is that? Likely to cause death. And mark this. Now come to section 300, limb 3. Here, culpable homicide amounts to murder when, thirdly, if it is done with the intention of causing bodily injury. You see, there also intention. Here also there is intention. What is the intention? There also intention to cause bodily injury. Here also intention is to cause bodily injury. When culpable homicide becomes murder, then when and the bodily injury intended to be inflicted is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause the death. Intended to be caused. It has got a different aspect. If I am asked to differentiate between section 219 and 300, this will become very important. Now for our today's discourse, this is not required, therefore I omit it simply. But nature of the injury here, what is the nature of the injury? Sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause the death. You please see the difference. Section 219, it says likely to cause death, bodily injury which is likely to cause death. Here section 300 says bodily injury which is sufficient to cause death. What is likely to cause death? Is there any definition in the IPC? No. What is sufficient to cause death? Is there any definition in the IPC? No. Is there any definition, any forensic book also? you go to Moody's medical jurisprudence, Taylor, or any book for that matter, there is nothing said as to whether this particular injury is likely to cause death or it is graver, that it is sufficient to cause death. Nowhere you will find the definition for that. But we have been applying the difference between likely to cause death and sufficient to cause death right from 1862. For how many years you have been using without there being any definite concrete definition for these two, we have been using. Therefore, friends, to understand the difference between these two, you should know the forensic medicine. And apart from that, in what context that forensic medicine, to what extent that forensic medicine can be applied to differentiate these two is also important. Now, you keep these two differences. Okay? Now, come to section 320. Now, 320, what is grievous? The following kinds of hurt only are designated as grievous. What is grievous? Eighth class, you please kindly read. Any hurt which endangers life or which causes the sufferer to be the hospitalization, we are not concerned with it. Any hurt which endangers human life. What is life? You go to section 45 of IPC. We say the word life denotes the life of a human being unless the contrary appears from the context. So what is life? It is defined. What? It is the human life of a human being. That's all is the definition. It's a very, very, very brief definition. Now, keeping that definition in your mind, endangers life. Now, here also hurt is caused. Hurt means, suppose an injury is caused. The term injury is defined in section 44. We say the word injury denotes any harm, whatever illegally caused to any person in body, mind, reputation, or property. That is injury. So it is not only injury caused physically to the human body, it is injury caused to the mind, it is injury caused to the reputation, it is injury caused to property. Also, these are all injuries. Now, hurt is nothing but an injury. Hurt. Just see the definition. 319, you come to section 319 now. Whoever causes bodily pain, disease, infirmity to any person is said to cause hurt. So any harm. So pain is a harm, disease is a harm, infirmity is a harm. Therefore, hurt is nothing but an injury. Very good. Every injury is not hurt, but every hurt is an injury. Okay? Injury means injury caused to the body, mind, reputation, property. All these things are injuries. But so far, hurt is concerned. Whoever causes bodily pain, it is a harm caused to the body. Disease, harm caused to the body. Infirmity, harm caused to the body. These things, therefore, a hurt is an injury in terms of section 44 of IPC. Okay. Now, come to section 320 again, eighthly. Any hurt, that means any injury, which endangers life. Now, if the injury is in the nature of only endangering human life, then it is grievous. If the injury is likely to cause death, it is culpable homicide. If the injury is sufficient to cause death, it is murder. So from out of the nature of the injury, we are asked to say whether it is only a grievous hurt, or it is culpable homicide, or it is murder. This distinction we have understood for more than 150 years, though there is no definition for these three terms. What is endangering human life? Nothing. What is sufficient? Nothing. What is likely? Nothing. There is no definition. But what is our understanding of this, friends? Now, when the doctor comes to the court, what does he say regarding cause of death? He says, death was due to this. Okay. Then he says, there are some injuries on the body. Doctor says, death was due to this injury. Suppose the leg is amputated. Leg is amputated. The doctor gives opinion. Yes, death was due to this injury. Now, whether this injury is sufficient to cause death or likely to cause death. If it is not sufficient to cause death, then the man will not be punished for murder under 302. We kindly keep in our mind the nature of the injury. Leg is amputated. Man dies out of that. He is taken to the hospital. He dies out of that. Doctor gives opinion. Death was due to the amputation of leg. Okay. What is the cause? Cause was the injury caused by the accused on the leg. Amputation. No doubt. That has been proved. Now, the next examination is whether it is murder or culpable homicide. If the prosecution is able to show that death was due to this, able to prove that this injury on the leg is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature, then it is murder. If the court holds, no, this is not sufficient, it is only likely, then the man is liable to be punished for culpable homicide, not amounting to murder under 304 part 1 alone. It makes all the difference. But doctor will simply say death due to the injury to leg. If you do not cross-examine, and what is the nature of the injury? It is to be said by the prosecution. Now, mostly what they will do, even at the time of examination of the doctor under section 161, the policeman will tell the doctor, doctor, whether this is sufficient? Yes, the man is dead. Therefore, it is sufficient. Man is dead. In the parlance of the doctor, in the understanding of the doctor, this injury is sufficient to cause death. Why? Death has occurred. There is no other cause. This was the only cause. Man is no more. Therefore, in the estimation or in the idea of the doctor, this injury is sufficient to cause death. Therefore, he will tell the court. One question will be asked by the prosecutor. Doctor, whether this injury is sufficient to cause death in the ordinary course of nature? Doctor will say, yes, yes, this is sufficient. That will be recorded. Then the court at the time of judgment, I have seen it, therefore I am saying it. Court will say, the doctor has given clear opinion that this injury is sufficient to cause death, therefore it is murder. Now friends, here your job becomes very, very responsible and onerous. Now, if you yourself do not understand, the doctor need not know the difference because he does not know what is in the ordinary course of nature. He does not know in the legal sense. He does not know whether it is sufficient or not in terms of section 300. The doctor does not know whether it is likely in terms of section 290. He does not know. He will say death was caused by this injury, therefore it is sufficient invariably in all cases. It is his understanding. His understanding has got nothing to do with 290 or 300. Therefore, we as legal experts should know the difference. What is the difference now? How to cross-examine the doctor? Now, likely, suppose I give three illustrations. There is one injury on my finger, that is on my index finger. There is one injury. This finger is amputated. I am taken to the hospital. Septicemia develops. Man dies. Ultimately, man dies after 30 days. Man dies. Whether death was due to what? Doctor will say death was due to septicemia. Septicemia was due to injury to finger. That injury to finger was caused by the accused. Therefore, the accused has caused the death. Okay? Accused has caused. That is how the link is established. Death was caused by the accused. Assuming that death was caused by the accused. Whether it is likely to cause death or sufficient to cause death? If you are able to establish that this injury is not even likely to cause death, then it will not be culpable homicide said even, and as a result it will not be murder. So this is a first injury. You take another injury. An injury is caused on the leg. Leg is amputated near the thigh. Okay, leg is amputated. Man is taken to the hospital. Man develops septicemia. He is also in the hospital for 30 days. He dies. Doctor will say death was due to septicemia. Septicemia was due to the injuries, injury to leg, and that injury was caused by the accused. Witnesses have said. Therefore, court will say death was caused by this person. Okay, here also death was caused by this accused. You take another illustration. On the abdomen, a forceful cut is made. The bowel comes, intestine, big, large intestine, everything they come out. Man is taken to the hospital. He is in the hospital for 30 days. There also, septicemia develops. Man dies. In all the three people are in three different hospitals. In all the three cases, what will be the case of the prosecution? The man caused the death. Okay, man has caused the death. In the first case, that is finger injury, where it will be culpable homicide, or it is murder. Secondly, in the second case, leg injury, leg is amputated, whether it is culpable homicide or murder. Come to the third case, abdominal injury, whether death was due to that or not, whether he caused the death or not, whether it is sufficient or not, or some chest injury. There is injury to lung. He taken. So in these cases, how to establish about the nature of the injury, whether it is sufficient, likely, this difference. Now friends, the test is this. This has been evolved by various judgments of our courts, commencing from Birsa Singh 1958 Supreme Court. From that onwards, you have to read. 1958 Birsa Singh case is a very popular case by Justice Vivian Bose. So what is the difference? If any injury is caused, please, for your basic understanding, I am saying this in a very simple manner. If any injury is caused to the man may die. So it is possible. The man may die. It is possible, is it not? Here in this case, the finger injury has caused the death. It is possible. But if it is not a mere possibility, it is somewhat likely, then only it becomes an offense of culpable homicide. So death cause of the death due to the injury is not a mere possibility, that is a remote possibility. It should be likely. Then if it is certain, or if the death is probable, then the injury is sufficient. This is the test. One is possibility. Second one is likely. Third one is probability. That is almost certainty. This is the distinction, brothers. Now, how to draw the distinction while examining the doctor? These two sections do not relate to the individual. I have already told you, so far as the nature of the injury is concerned, the test is objective. Objective means a particular injury caused to me, caused to A, may cause his death. Suppose the same injury is caused to B, he may not die. For example, we have seen people surviving even after amputation of leg. We have seen many cases, is it not? After one leg is amputated, man survives. It happens. There are also cases where after amputation, man dies. It also happens. So both are possible. But the test is whether chances for death are more, or chances for survival are more. Which chance is more? That is the test. Suppose there are 100 people who sustain this kind of injury. If many have not died, only few persons have died, that means chances for survival is more chances for death is less.
Yes.
Death is less. So when chances for death is very less and survival is more, the nature of the injury is likely in terms of Section 299. So if it is, if the injury, if it is caused to several persons, if the chance for survival is more, chance for death is very less, then the injury is likely to cause death. Similarly, if the chances for death is more imminent or more, chances for survival is less, then it is sufficient. Okay, it is sufficient to cause death in terms of Section 300. So you should not stop by simply saying, no doctor, this injury is not sufficient as it is opined by you. That is not sufficient. You should establish from out of the medical authorities, authoritative books, as to whether this injury is likely or sufficient. How many? What is the possibility for death? What is the possibility? What is the percentage of death? You have to ask the doctor, what is the percentage? If you are able to show yes, percentage of survival is 70, percentage of death is 30, then you will succeed in establishing that it is not sufficient. Okay? So chances for, in terms of percentage, whether survival is more than 50% or chances for death is more than 50%, you have to establish through the from the doctor, during cross-exam, you have to establish. You have to ask the doctor, suppose this kind of injury is caused, what is the percentage of death? He will say, yes, 70% people will die, 30% people will survive. It is sufficient. No, 70%, almost around 70% of people will survive. Only 30% will die. Then you need not ask the doctor whether it is sufficient or likely. Doctor does not know Section 299 or 300, it's an ICT. Doctor need not say. You ask the doctor, what is the percentage of survival of the person who sustained this kind of injury? The doctor says, yes, survival chance is 70%. Okay. Death is 30%. Yes, death is 30%. Then you succeed in establishing that it is not a case of sufficient to cause the death in terms of Section 300 IPC. Okay. That is the difference between these two. So, mere possibility, if it is only possible, but death has not occurred, it is not culpable homicide at all. In the first illustration where I said that there was injury caused to the finger, death was due to septicemia. Death is possible, but still it will not fall under Section 299 at all. Here the man is to be punished only for the offense under Section 326. Though the man has died, you have to punish him only under Section 326 IPC because the injury is in the nature of endangering human life. Understand this. In the nature of endangering human life. Though the man is no more, because of the injury on the index finger, this injury is neither likely to cause death nor sufficient to cause death. Therefore, though death has occurred, the accused is to punish only for offense under Section 326 because this injury is in the nature of endangering human life. Over? Very good. Now, if you are able to establish or if you are able to show that the injury is likely to cause not only endangering, it is likely to cause death, where chances for survival is more, chances for death is less, then the accused will be punished under 304, part 1 of IPC. Suppose the prosecution is able to establish, no, this is something graver. This is not a simple endangering. This is not a simple likely. This is something graver. That is, this is sufficient because chances for death are more than chances for survival. If they are going to establish, if they are able to establish this, then the accused will be punished for murder. Friends, see, an accused cannot be punished for an offense which he has not committed. It will be doing injustice to him. If he has committed only an offense punishable under Section 326, punishing him for offense under section 304 or 302 will be doing injustice. Similarly, a person who has committed murder, if he is punished only for 304, that will also amount to doing injustice. Therefore, appropriately, this is a very onerous, risky job of a lawyer as well as a judge to find the difference and then to punish. Now, if you have to establish the distinction between these three definitions, terminologies used in three different sections, you should know the human anatomy. You are required to know the functioning of major systems in the human body. You should know as to how death occurs. That is why I started saying, first stoppage of the nervous system, then stoppage of this respiratory system, and finally it happens, that is stoppage of the circulatory system. In some cases, at the very beginning itself, circulatory system may fail. Suppose there is an injury caused to the lung, to the heart straight away. Suppose there is a punctured wound, or there a person is shot and it pierces the heart. Heart immediately stops. So man dies. Then in that case, the other things follow later. That is simultaneously at least. So somatic death, you should know there are three types. You would also know that the cellular death happens subsequently. This is the way in which you have to distinguish between these three. Now you please kindly come to section 307. How the medical, that is a topic today, therefore I am confining myself. I am not going very detailed into the forensic science because I am looking at it in the legal angle. You come to section 307, attempt to murder. Whoever does any act with such intention or knowledge and under such a circumstance that if he by that act caused the death, he would be guilty of murder, shall be punished. Suppose an injury is caused by the accused. If the man dies, then if it is established that the injury is sufficient to cause death, then it is murder, he will be punished. Now here what has not happened, death has not occurred. But nature of the injury should be proved to be sufficient to cause death. Then only 307. Correct? See the difference here. But this distinction is seldom seen by the lawyers and the court. So what has to be seen? He has caused the injury. Yes. Intentionally? Yes. No. Will it be an attempt to commit murder? So in order to make it an attempt to commit murder, it should fall under any one of the limbs of 300. Now, for our discussion, we have taken limb 3 of 300. Thirdly of 300, we say, sufficient to cause death. Now, here in this case, the man should have caused an injury which is sufficient to cause death in the ordinary course of nature. But the man has not died because of medical intervention. Man survives because of medical intervention. Otherwise, man would have died. This injury is sufficient. In no 307 case, I have seen. So I want to modify. Almost in most of the cases, I have not seen that any such fact established that but for the medical intervention, the man would have died, number one. Two, this injury is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause death, but here it has not caused death because of the medical intervention. If this is absent, the man cannot be punished under 307. He can be punished only under section 326. How many of us have distinguished this in our everyday practice? In no case, almost. So I want to modify it again. I have not seen in any case where the prosecution establishing, yes, here these are the injuries caused by the accused, yes. These are the injuries but the man has not died. Why? Though these injuries are sufficient to cause death, man did not die because of the medical intervention. Otherwise, the man would have died because it is sufficient to cause death. Regarding the nature of the injury, no question is put. And we also do not worry about that. People are convicted under section 307 instead of 326. See the difference. So, in order to distinguish between 326 and 307, we normally go by the intention. Whether he had intention to cause the death or not. We go by that. There is one more aspect to that. Very important that too. That is by the nature of the injury. Distinction can certainly be made. If the prosecution is able to show this, please kindly, friends, kindly note. The accused caused these injuries, one, two. These injuries are sufficient to cause death, two. But in this case, the man has not died. Though injuries are sufficient, man has not died. Why? Because of the medical intervention. Unless this evidence is available, the accused cannot be convicted under 307. He can be convicted only under section 326 because it is endangering human life. It is a harm cause. It is in the nature of endangering human life. He can be punished only under section 326. So between 326 and 307 also, medical opinion plays a vital role. Medical evidence plays a vital role. All right. Now come to section 308 now. See, come to section 308. Have we seen any case where instead of 307, the accused is punished under section 308? Almost this section is a forgotten section. This section is almost a forgotten section. But I can claim that as a judge, I have dealt with cases where I have punished people. In fact, I have modified the conviction from 307 to 308. See what 308 says. Whoever does any act with such intention or knowledge under such circumstances that if he by that act caused death, he would be guilty of culpable homicide. Culpable homicide. Then punishment is under section 308. So the distinction between 307 and 308 is, if under 307, going by the injury I am saying, not going by the intention, injury, if the injury is sufficient to cause death, man survives because of medical intervention, 307. If the injury is only likely to cause death, man survives because of medical intervention, he can be punished only under section 308 of IPC and not 307. You see, the punishment provided under section 307, it is life sentence. Under section 308, the maximum punishment is only 7 years. It makes all the difference. This distinction can also be established by knowing the difference between likely and sufficient. Though man survives because of the medical intervention, if the prosecution is able to establish that the injury is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature, he has to be punished under section 307. If the prosecution is not able to prove that, but instead it is proved that the injury is only likely to cause death, but the man survives because of the medical intervention, he can be punished not under 307, but under 308 only. Similarly, if it is proved that the injury was only possible, not likely, not sufficient, he can be punished under section 326 IPC. See the difference. So that is how, brother, the medical evidence plays a vital role going by the nature of the injuries. Now, there are so many other aspects. Like section 84 you take. Section 84 speaks of insanity. How medical evidence plays a role in that? How to establish medical insanity? In terms of section 84. Not in terms of medical science. In terms of IPC, section 84. Then how to assess the time of death? No time today. How to assess the time of death? So I have only highlighted the distinction between these three injuries and how to establish from the doctor. Friends, you may feel that I am guilty of repetition, I want to say that while cross-examining the doctor or when the doctor is under examination, he will have only medical knowledge and he will say, because there is a death, the injury is sufficient. That is not binding. That is not conclusive. The court is not bound by the opinion. He has to establish by means of cross-examination, fixing the percentage of the death which occurs due to these injuries. That is how that you have to do. And there are other areas about the precise cause of death, how to prove that in a decomposed body, how to prove the cause of death. Then from what are the nature of the injuries, what are the natures, incise to wound, then contusion, abrasion, laceration, and how the weapon is to be correlated. All these things and the distinction between strangulation and suicidal hanging, they will squarely fall within the ambit of forensic science. So I don't have time today that I will do. Similarly, in the case of rape, the medical evidence plays a vital role. And another friends, you know, only one judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court in Lillu alias Rajesh versus State of Haryana 2013-14 SCC, page 643. In this case, the Honorable Supreme Court after several years has taken the view that the two-finger test is inhuman and it is degrading, therefore the doctor should not do. And the court should not also record any evidence on that aspect. The matter is again now being examined by the Supreme Court and the matter is still pending. That Lillu case is over, but the Honorable Supreme Court has taken up Suomoto writ petition criminal number 4/2019, where the Honorable Supreme Court has called for reports from various state governments as to whether these directions of the Honorable Supreme Court in Lillu case have been complied with or not. So with this, brothers, I think that the time is up. I can close. And before closing, I want to say only one thing. Medical science is not perfect and it stands only on approximation, and therefore we have to study the subject very thoroughly, not only in the angle of a doctor doing forensic medicine, but in the angle of law, like section 299-300, which I have highlighted, some of the provisions I have highlighted in respect of offenses against the human body. Please, friends, and if time permits, and if you are also interested, I will do only the forensic medicine exclusively. That time I will say about the assessment of time of death, how it is assessed, cause of death, how cause of death is found out, how time of death is assessed, and how the injury is correlated to the weapon. These three aspects may require another 2 hours time for me, and if for time permits, I will do. With this, I thank all our friends who had patience to watch this webinar and showing some enthusiasm in learning this medical science. I would only say, brothers and sisters, that unless you are very thorough, as the saying goes, an advocate should be an expert in every field, not like a doctor who is expected to be an expert in medical science, like an engineer who is expected to be an expert in engineering science. A lawyer is expected to be an expert of every science or every other subject. Therefore, please kindly read this forensic science, know the importance of this forensic medicine. Many cases, friends, are lost because of because of our ill-equipment in this subject. So equip yourself and be an expert in this field also, and see that there is no injustice caused to anybody. As I have told you already, a person who has committed an offense can be punished only for that offense, not for a different offense. A person who has committed an offense under Section 326 by causing a simple hurt on the finger cannot be punished for murder. It will be doing injustice. Therefore, please be informed of, well informed of this subject. Kindly don't neglect this subject. Why I am stressing more on this subject is that all the other subjects relating to law are taught in the law college, whereas though we have been requesting the universities, the law universities, to include this forensic medicine and the forensic science as subject in the curriculum, I do not know why this is not taken seriously off by the authorities concerned. Therefore, I am saying that this is the one subject which you have to learn only during your practice. Kindly do that. Thank you very much.
I request this is Anand Mingresh to interview just now.
Sir, good morning. Meaning how important this subject is and how we have neglected it so far, this forensic medicine, and how we blindly go, as you rightly say, the doctor is not expected to know the nuances of 299 and 300. And we'll have to, as advocates, we'll have to establish it by getting the answers from the doctors and bringing it within 299, 300 or 320, as you say. And all these things are possible only if an advocate does trial practice, or else these things are never going to improve. But I'm sure, sir, with your repeated lectures, many are benefited, including me. I'll have to put myself. I am also sitting like a student.
I want to intervene. We are benefited by all your lectures. I've been very closely watching all your lectures. Fantastic lectures that you are making. And in fact, I was enthralled by your lecture in that ILS law school, differentiating Section 290 and 300. I was really very happy about that. And because we do not know the difference, it is my really anguish, I can say, because we do not know the differences of these sections, the distinctions, and also the role, main role played by the medical evidence. So we are, say, many a times, and with a heavy heart, we may have to decide a case, though we are not very sure whether this would have happened or this would have happened, and what is the offense actually committed. Thank you very much for your presence.
And if we don't understand the medical jurisprudence, then it is impossible to explain likely, probably, etc. Endangering life, all that is words. But if we want to really understand the purport of it, unless and otherwise we are able to understand the medical science to an extent, it becomes impossible. And that's what has come out of your lecture, sir. So,
absolutely correct, sir. In your experience as your honorable judge and previously as your advocate, have you seen detailed cross-examination or chief examination on these aspects?
In fact, this 307 and 308 was a revelation. Meaning, every lecture I sit and listen only because we learn a lot of things, because the speaker really prepares it and does it. When it comes to your lecture, I learn a lot of new things. A lot of new things every time. And thank you. You are doing a great service to this institution. Thank you. The institution is benefited out of you.
Thank you. See, if I may say so, if I am not mistaken, as a lawyer, I would request our friends also to take permission to go to the medical college, see the internal organs of the body, go to the anatomy department, see the body structure and all that. And similarly, with the permission of the authorities, see the postmortem conducted. Sir, I have visited the anatomy department many a times. I know the entire structure of the human body. And before going for a cross-exam with any doctor, I used to consult the doctors. I used to discuss, and for days together, I used to discuss, read books. Then I also, with permission, the dean has to give permission. I have seen one or two postmortems also. So we have to go and see. Then only we can learn. So during my practice as a lawyer, I used to concentrate more in this medical science. I used to establish this distinction. Ms. Karnanidhi knows that.
Yes.
We conducted many cases together, and he used to represent the prosecutor. We conducted a number of cases. So it is very interesting.
Postmortem பார்த்து நாங்க கீழே விழுந்துட்டா கஷ்டமா போயிடுவாங்க.
புதுசா வந்து மெடிக்கல் காலேஜ் ஸ்டூடெண்ட் மாதிரி மயங்கி விழாம இருக்கும்.
But it needs permission from the dean.
Yes.
The Judicial Academy can do that, sir. They can take the permission if the academy goes and seeks permission.
Sir, Honorable Justice Anantham Gresh knows that during training for the judicial officer, we used to send them to the MMC for seeing postmortem.
Postmortem.
Yes. Field trips, man.
See the postmortem. Mm-hmm. Yes. And also to the forensic lab to see as to how so many examinations like fingerprint examination, DNA, everything, they are done. We used to send them. It is done. But we, for lawyers, we do not have any chance. Mm-hmm. And therefore, bar association should take up.
Take the initiative, yes, sir.
Yes, the initiative, and they should write and get permission appropriately. Take the lawyers and see the postmortem and humanity, more particularly humanity. When I was so young, the medical college used to conduct this this exhibition. During that time, we will go and see the dead body inside, and they will show heart and like that.
As a continuation, if it happens, we will have more clarity in the when we go into the real what it means by continuation, what it means by laceration, what it means. These are things which are very important. Difference between the strangulation and the breaking of hyoid bone when it happens, etc. Yes. Et yes. When we hear it from you,
very often I tell you in my experience, I have seen very often. So far as this hyoid bone is concerned, there are two things in that. One is antemortem fracture.
Yes.
The other one is postmortem subluxation.
Yes. Which you have dealt with in one case, in a case of burn injury. Okay. In a case of burn injury while moving the body. After the death, this will break.
Yes.
So where you have said that was fabulous. That was something which a person who knows about medical jurisprudence only can do it. Please.
Yes, I'll do it. So this is also important. This postmortem, see, this antemortem fracture and postmortem subluxation.
Yes.
And I tell you that even many doctors who are not experts in forensic science, they bungled.
Yes.
They bungled. They do not know the difference between these two. Similarly, the difference between antemortem injury and postmortem injury. So in a decomposed body.
Yes.
They struggle a lot to distinguish.
In fact, when they move a body to the ambulance, it's possible that the hyoid bone will break.
Will break.
The way in which they place a body, it will break. We surely want your lecture on that.
The last week I argued one case before the Honorable Supreme Court through this video conferencing, in which I one of my arguments was that there was one abrasion in the body. I said that this abrasion could have been caused when the man was taken to the hospital. Because in the accident register, there was no such mention about the doctor. So these are the we should understand the importance of cross-examining the doctor. See, many of us do like this. So I will say, suppose there is an injury on the, three injuries on the head. So I have seen this in one case. You know what is the suggestion? அப்படியே குப்பர் அவர் விழுந்தா அவங்க ஒரு பாயிண்டட் வெப்பன் இருந்தா அந்த காயம் வருமா? வரும். ஒரு காயம் வரும். அப்புறம் இன்னொரு தடவை விழுந்தா வருமா? வரும். அப்புறம் மூணாவது தடவை விழுந்தா அப்போ விழுந்தா வரும். How unnatural the difference taken is.
Correct. Yes, I'll only say one thing. There are so many youngsters in this state who are very carefully watching your lectures regularly. I am sure that there will be a lot of SMJs who will come in future.
Thank you very much.
I am very, very confident about it. You are a great inspiration to many youngsters here.
Thank you so much for your great contribution. Thank you for the nice words.
Vanakkam, Arun Bidiyan Shekhar. Hello, only one question with regard to accident register. If the victim tells the names of the person or accused who caused the injury, whether the names can be recorded in the accident register?
Supreme Court says, so the doctor...
I understand
the question.
Yes.
Supreme Court, in one of the decisions, has said that the doctor is not expected to write. Correct?
Yes.
That is a word used. But it doesn't, the Supreme Court does not say the doctor should not write. Suppose the doctor has mentioned the names, then there is nothing wrong. You can see hundreds of judgments where the contradiction in respect to identity of the person as mentioned in the act and register and the prosecution case is highlighted and the accused are given the benefit. So there is nothing wrong in that. Whatever is stated, he has to write.
There is no legal bar to record the names.
Correct.
Supreme Court specifically says doctors are not expected to write. That's all. It doesn't say the doctor should not write. So it means the doctor should not make a roving inquiry there. Instead of treating the patient, he should not write. Suppose there are 40 people. If he starts writing all the 40 names, then what will happen? Therefore, Supreme Court says that they are not expected to do all these things. Suppose there is only one single person. Man says that so-and-so, somebody really did this. Then it can be done in a fraction of the second. Nothing yes. wrong. So in a way, the Supreme Court says, you cannot blame the doctor for not recording the names. That is all.
Yes.
Yes, yes. Please.
Sir, please explain neurogenic shock.
So that we will cover later. Vagal shock and neurogenic shock.
Neurogenic
shock. And yes, all these shocks will give a shock next time.
I am not relieved from the shock. In Thiruvanam case,
yes.
I am not relieved from the neurogenic shock.
Vagal shock. Vagal
shock. In Thiruvanam case.
Yes, yes,
in police station case 376.
No, the doctor simply say death due to hemorrhagic shock. Doctor say, and unless we know what is hemorrhage, what is the shock, and what amount of blood should have gone out of the body, unless we know, it will not be possible to cross examine. So these things will come under strictly under forensic medicine. We'll do it next time.
Thank you, sir.